Hi, I'm John Iredale, Pro Vice-Chancellor for Health and Life Sciences here at the University of Bristol. And I'd like to welcome you all to our third podcast. As those of you that have seen the first two will know, these are fireside chats where we meet colleagues working at the university who are at the forefront of research into how we should respond to the COVID pandemic, including those that are dealing with not just the virus, infections, epidemiology, but those that are looking at the ways in which we can address our behaviours and activities as we learn to deal with an altered way of life. Now, many of you will have noticed that in contrast to the Spanish and Italian governments, when lockdown was introduced in the UK, our government was completely clear that individuals would be allowed out of their residences in order to take some exercise. What I'm interested in doing today is exploring what the rationale for that was and why it is so important. And I have to say it takes a bit of a personal angle because I speak as the parent of a son who lives in Italy and has been effectively imprisoned in a flat for the better part of 8 weeks, unable to get out at all. So to answer these questions, it's my enormous pleasure and I'm very delighted to welcome Dr. Charlie Foster OBE, who's the leader in physical activity and public health here at the university, and he's chair of the UK Chief Medical Officer's Expert Committee for Physical Activity. Charlie, welcome.
Thank you, John, and my apologies to your poor son locked down in Italy, but the Italians have taken a different view of the science to the UK, and I think we were lucky that all the four chief medical officers had very recently published population guidelines to support the promotion of physical activity. And the current circumstances, the overwhelming evidence was not necessarily about the cardiovascular or kind of physiological benefits, but about the mental health benefits of getting out. So I feel really sorry for your poor son, locked in Italy, unable to get out. And actually, we wanted to maintain the opportunity for a once a day offer for the UK public, those the population that could obviously go outside.
I'm sure my son Duncan would agree with you. We'd probably better stop talking about him. He'll be very grumpy that he's featured in this. So I'd be very interested to hear a little bit more about your research and how it informed this decision making.
Okay, so my background is an epidemiologist. I'm now a fully converted social scientist as well. And my job has been to help take the epidemiology, bend it to the science, and put it into policy. And the good news for that is constructing physical activity guidelines is something that we've been very, very keen to do at the National Centre, our centre at Bristol. The science that we've used, the evidence to construct these guidelines, has come from a wide variety of trials, big epidemiological studies, etc. And we've got a big UK network of experts, including folk from UOB, who've been involved in their construction. And really, there's an overwhelming case to say that it'd be much better to allow people to take this daily exercise in a safe and responsible way that's not going to spread the virus. And we were really keen to make sure that that was on the table the whole time during discussions.
So presumably it was of concern to you and others when a few weeks ago Matt Hancock announced, perhaps as a little bit of a threat, that if social distancing rules weren't observed, we would go for an Italian or a Spanish model of lockdown.
I think it was probably a kickback to those early days when everyone was a little bit uncertain about the guidance and the regulations and how they were being interpreted. And I'm sure if they'd spoken to the many members of the law faculty, they'd have pointed out some of the kind of the grey areas in the actual construction of the guidance, which the public really weren't receiving clearly, were trying to work out what they could and couldn't do. And I think now everyone's a little bit clearer about what they can and cannot do. We've all got a little bit more used to it. And in fact, if you look at the latest polls in YouGov, 70% of the population are happy for the, well, happy is not the right word, but are accepting that the lockdown should continue. So I think we've kind of bedded in a little bit. There's always going to be non-compliance to any kind of population recommendation or regulation. We just have to look at our roads in normal times and look at the speed limits. So we are always going to have those folk, and as long as we can make sure that they understand why they shouldn't do it and that they're under control, I think we're in a relatively strong place for that.
That's good. And presumably there is a specific angle to this associated with specific concerns when we're considering children and teenagers.
Yes, and a father of a 15-year-old daughter who's currently in lockdown, unable to see her friends. This is a really important issue. You know, they're much more connected online than perhaps we are in our generation, but that's only up to a certain point. And what probably worries me more is the post-COVID lockdown party that they will unleash upon each other, and how we'll manage that as parents. But that's probably a different issue. Physical activity is important at any age, right from cradle right up to grave. We've got recommendations for under fives and teens and young adults. And certainly I know that, you know, there are lots of provision online for this particular group. And we can only see the popularity of Joe Wicks's physical education sessions every day to know that there's an appetite for the nation to kind of keep moving.
Is there any evidence? I guess a period of lockdown that lasts a few weeks, we've got to hope that there will be no lasting hangover in terms of behaviours. But is there evidence that if as a child you undertake regular exercise, that's a pattern that you carry on into teenage years and perhaps even beyond?
Well, we've seen some evidence of tracking. Certainly we know that the unhealthy behaviours that are associated with a lack of physical activity, like BMI, poor mental health, etc., do track as well. So there is a connection. It's not hugely clear, but we certainly know that inactive kids are more likely to end up as inactive adults. And we know that the COVID lockdown has reduced the opportunity, particularly for team sports for children, and the opportunity just to go out and play. You know, yeah. All of us would benefit from that, and they find struggling with that really, really much. So there will be a real challenge. And I know colleagues, Professor Russ Jago from our centre, is looking at the educational return, what are people going to do in schools, to kind of pick up this pattern of activity that kids are now locked into. And we suspect there may be obviously a strong inequalities angle as well. Those who have the least resources and access to active environments and supportive activities will be further behind their perhaps more affluent counterparts. So we have to redress that balance that the lockdown may currently be causing.
Yeah, no, I can see that's really important. I guess an obvious question that people will be wanting me to ask is, do you have any tips for our staff, colleagues, family members and friends stuck in lockdown?
Oh, goodness. You're harking me back to my days when I used to wear lycra and do aerobics classes. I prefer not to give people personal advice. But what I will say, if it makes you happy, keep doing it. And if you're doing it and it's fun, then keep doing it. Continue after lockdown ends. If you're at home and you're with people at home who can't get out, there's some really good resources on the Sport England website. And one of the great things the centre's been doing at Bristol is helping Sport England check the accuracy of the evidence within those resources. And we're offering a kind of almost like a passport check and send service for national agencies at the moment. And the get active at home or get active outdoors resources on the Sport England website, hundreds of different things to choose from, a whole menu. So if you're short of an idea, have a little peruse on there and have a little play.
So that sounds like a fantastic tip. Sport England website, and you heard it here first, University of Bristol have played a crucial role in validating, as it were, the activities and their impact. That's great to hear. That's terrific to hear. Okay, so thinking about the future then, what about research post-COVID? What about what you're going to get up to when lockdown ends?
Okay, I've already shared one idea that we're doing. We're particularly interested in the kind of the distribution of activity across the population. There are a number of surveys going on. We'll probably look to combine the data as best we can, and then to look at the inequalities that may exist spatially and also within SES groups and what the solutions are to that. But I think for me, the real challenge is how do we actually deal and treat with people post-COVID infection? We go back to the days of TB management. We used to put people in sanatoriums and give them fresh air. we need a pathway for recovery that involves all the major sort of clinical services, and then what happens when they go home, because the long-term effects of COVID are sort of suspected, and there will be long-term effects for physiological and also psychological as well. And if we can establish a really good treatment pathway, recovery, convalescence, and community-based work, that would be fantastic. And I reckon we're in a good place at UOB to do that.
That's terrific. That's great news. Well, listen, you've been very kind. I know you're extremely busy and you've been extremely generous with your time. It's been wonderful to speak to you. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks, John. Good luck, everybody.